In April of 1990, the American space shuttle Discovery launched up from the Earth into a higher orbit than ever before to deploy a special payload, the Hubble Space Telescope. Above even the thinnest parts of the atmosphere, Hubble would be able to see far-off stars and galaxies without distortion and expand our understanding of the distant past. Or at least, that was the plan. But by June, it was clear there was something very wrong. The telescope, with one of the most perfectly ground mirrors, couldn't focus properly. Apparently, the first great space observatory was short-sighted. Hubble's 2.5-metre or 8.2-foot mirror was rendered incapable by an error in its shape less than 1/50th of the width of a human hair. The primary mirror suffered from what is known as spherical aberration, more often found in sloppily made amateur telescope projects, not multi-million dollar space telescopes. However, this was a problem almost a decade in the making. NASA had contracted the private firm Perkin-Elmer to make Hubble's optical assembly and the fine guidance system. Construction of a primary mirror began in 1979 and was completed in 1981. But during these years, the whole project was under threat. Costs were rising and the schedule to deliver on time was slipping. NASA put the heat on the management of Perkin-Elmer, pushing them to keep up with the schedule or lose the contract. Behind the scenes, the polishing and testing of the primary mirror was underway. Because Hubble's mirror was an aspherical design, it required special apparatus to check its quality, known as a null corrector. Perkin-Elmer even designed their own high-specification reflective null corrector, or RNC, to test the exact standard of 1 micrometer, or 1/1000th of a millimeter, as required for the space telescope. The RNC was a cylinder, 76 centimeters, 2.5 feet high, and about 0.5 meter, or 1.5 feet wide. Inside, two mirrors and a lens were arranged to create a wavefront on the Hubble primary mirror below. If the mirror was fabricated perfectly, this wavefront would show no contour lines, hence the null in the instrument's name. The apparatus was approved and set up on a tower in a dedicated room, a process that took 2 weeks. The position of the RNC's lens was measured by an Invar rod, a precision-made and measured rod of nickel-iron alloy named for its invariability, specifically low expansion under different temperatures. If the length of this rod varied by even a fraction of a millimeter, the test measurements would be wrong and the mirror would be ground to the wrong shape. As the technicians lowered the lens of the RNC into position, they noticed they couldn't get it all to fit together. The Invar rod stuck out by just over a millimeter. The ends of the Invar rod were rounded and polished because the positioning system used a light interferometer rather than a mechanical measurement. As part of this process, a focused beam of light was reflected off the end of the Invar rod. To make sure that it was focused exactly on the center of the rod end, field caps were fitted to hold the rods in position laterally. These caps had a hole in the center to allow the focus beam to hit the rod end and a non-reflective surface coating around it. At some point, a small section of this non-reflective coating on one of the field caps was chipped off around the center hole. When the technician was setting up the focused beam, he got a reflection from the chipped area of the end cap instead of the rod end, which caused a 1.3 millimeter misplacing of the Invar rod. Rather than wasting time investigating why the assembly didn't match the Invar rod, the crew found 3 metal spacers and squeezed them into the bracket holding the lens. So now it agreed with the measuring rod. Then the RNC was left in place so as not to disturb its supposedly fine calibration. The result of this oversight in the assembly of the RNC would lead to the mirror being precisely polished, but with an error 10 times greater than the specified tolerance. Every day for 9 months, the crew polished the primary mirror, periodically moving it on its tracks to the null corrector to see how much closer they were to the final shape. At the end of the long process, the RNC gave a null result. At last, the so-called perfect mirror was finished. To verify the mirror's shape, a further test was carried out using a cruder refractive null corrector. But this test gave a different result. This time, it appears as though the Hubble's mirror had a flaw. But as the refractive null corrector had not been certified for testing against spherical aberration, the result was discounted. The fault had been found, but it had been ignored. And moreover, the discrepancy between the two tests had not been investigated further, and the written documentation of the fix with the spacers was also misplaced. Over the 4 years that the mirror was stored due to delays because of the Challenger shuttle disaster, several universities requested permission to test the mirror, but all were turned down because the manufacturers were confident about their own testing procedures. A decade later, the $1.5 billion space telescope was high above the Earth with a flawed mirror. There was a perfect backup mirror that had been made by Kodak, but it would have been impossible to replace the mirror once in orbit and too time-consuming and expensive to bring the Hubble back to Earth for refitting. So in 1993, an ambitious and expensive shuttle mission with 5 spacewalks managed to install corrective optics on the secondary mirror to fix the problem. When the cause of Hubble's trouble was eventually found, Perkin-Elmer agreed to pay a fine of $15 million, thereby avoiding a lawsuit by the government. Both Perkin-Elmer and NASA were heavily criticized for not picking up on the quality control issues and relying upon a single test instrument. Hubble is still in operation today and has been updated over the years, and it's expected that it will be in operation until between 2028 and 2040, when the natural decay in its orbit will bring it back to Earth if it is not reboosted into a higher orbit. Until then, it will continue to provide mankind with some of the most scientifically useful and inspirational views of our universe to date. So thanks for watching, and I'd just like to say that this episode's shirt was the Penny.Lane Retro Mod Polka Dot by Madcap England and is available at Atom Retro with worldwide shipping from here in the UK. Don't forget, we also have the Curious Droid Facebook page and group where you can suggest ideas for new videos. The link is in the channel page. And you can also translate any of the videos with the community contributions. So as always, thanks again for watching, and please subscribe, rate, and share.